Across the country, in Cambridgeshire, is Longthorpe Tower, the remaining fragment of a fortified manor house. And the site of some unique paintings.
This really is a hidden gem. The largest set of surviving medieval domestic wall paintings in Western Europe. They give really profound insight into Gothic lives and minds.
These paintings constitute an entire gallery of medieval preoccupations, build up a picture of the complex Gothic mind.
The Thorpe family that were responsible for these paintings have used these walls as canvases to express the things that were important to them, the things that concerned them. So over here, you have the king, balanced out with religious imagery, like the Nativity and the saints. And on this side, a really unusual image of the Wheel of Five Senses. You've got reason in the centre, dressed as a king, and each of the senses is represented as a different beast. So the monkey represents taste, the vulture smell, the spider's web touch, the boar hearing, and the cock ram here, sight. This sort of symbolism could chime with an idea of medieval man as superstitious, wrapped up in a world of esoteric symbolism. But this is balanced out on the other wall by this image of Aristotle teaching. So we have book learning here, education factoring into these paintings.
Perhaps the most startling image is one you notice leaving the room, a reminder that while medieval craftsmen built for eternity, their own lives were often brief. And now, death was about to deal the Gothic imagination a mighty blow.
Here we have an image from a popular medieval folktale. The story goes that three princes encounter three dead men, shown here by these dark cadavers. At the climax of the story, the dead say to the living, "As we are, so shall ye be." These paintings date to around 1340, but in the next few years, the spectre of death was to cast a shadow of unprecedented scale across Europe.
In 1348, a disease arrived in England from Europe, where it had already wiped out half the population. The Black Death was spread by the fleas of rats. The agonizing boils were a portent of imminent death. It seemed like the arrival of Judgment Day itself. At Arundel Castle in Sussex, it's possible to see the Gothic imagination taking a darker turn.
This is the FitzAlan Chapel in Arundel, and it provides a focused view of attitudes towards life and death at the height of the Gothic period. Here's the tomb of John FitzAlan. He was a Knight of the Garter, and he fought for Henry VI in the Hundred Years' War with France. His tomb monument is traditional in the way that a medieval knight would be commemorated after death. He's shown with all his symbols of social standing, his sword, his armour, his heraldry. But attitudes towards death in particular were changing. With the Black Death, there was an increasing sense that social status and wealth in this life were fleeting. How do you show that sort of intellectual change visually? Well, take a look down here. This is a transy tomb, so it acts as a reminder of human mortality. Here we have the John FitzAlan again, but he's cadaverous. He's emerging from his burial shroud, naked and decaying. In some transy tombs, you'd even have rats nibbling at the body, or worms appearing to writhe underneath the surface of the skin. These gory images, part of the legacy, I think, of the macabre ideas underlying Gothic. There's no rats or worms here, but you can tell that he's supposed to be decaying because of the sunken cheeks, the hollowed out eye sockets, the fact you can count every rib, and the way he covers his withered modesty. But why does this monument look like this? Surely this decaying, ugly corpse literally undermines the gravitas of John Fitzalan. Well, it wouldn't have seemed strange at the time. What this tomb reflects is a gradual change in the minds of medieval men and women, accelerated by the effects of the plague.
The decimated nobility was reminded that they were as vulnerable as ordinary folk. The reduced peasantry grew all the more powerful because they were more sought after for their labour. Now, the Gothic world was beginning to look almost modern. Its religious framework was also less certain.
Without spiritual leaders for guidance, people had to see to their souls themselves. You can see this most clearly in the writings of the English mystics, men like Richard Rolla, and women like Julian of Norwich and Marjorie Kemp. They worked outside of the established church. They were social outcasts who sought through hallucination, starvation, and meditation a personal and almost physical understanding of Christ's sufferings and ecstasies.
The plague had shaken the spiritual foundations of the church, just as it would threaten the very bricks and mortar of the church, even causing the construction of Winchester Cathedral to come to a standstill for 25 years. But the Spartan nature of Perpendicular made it a robust architecture, even in a time of crisis. After the plague, with fewer masons around, architecture would grow sparser still, but to ever greater visual effect. The interior at Winchester, immense and soaring to the heights with its impressive vaulting. York Minster, a perpendicular choir, and a new great east window to rival Gloucester's. St. Mary Redcliffe in Bristol, the most complete perpendicular interior in England. And the great octagonal lantern at Ely, a unique piece of construction that flowers upwards towards the heavens. The second half of the 14th century and the beginning of the 15th saw an explosion of Perpendicular, England's first truly national style of architecture had arrived. Canterbury too was remodeled, and today, the great perpendicular south window is undergoing restoration. Eroded stonework is being replaced with newly carved tracery. It's the work of Canterbury stonemason Emlyn Harris and his team.
So this is a diagram of what you guys are up to at the moment then?
Yeah, this is the drawing of the Great South Window. Yeah. We're replacing all of the stonework from this point here to what we call the springing line. It's contentious, you know, there's a lot of people that don't feel comfortable with that amount of stone replacement. However, the priority is firstly to maintain a safe structure and keep the stained glass, you know, in a safe environment.
And everything in pink you've done?
Everything in pink's done.
Still a bit to go.
There's still a little bit to go, yeah.
talk me through the process. We start off with just a bare block.
Yep, it's a new stone. So Ben and Sam are checking the stone for the dimensions. They're checking it square. Once they've done that, they'll then take the zinc template and they're going to scribe round that shape, and that is the shape that the finished stone needs to be.
Right. That becomes the core.
That becomes.
And then you work out everything
stone.
Else.
Yep.
Yeah. It looks like a very laborious process, but also I'm surprised how traditional the techniques they're using are.
Yeah, it's exactly the same way that stone has been marked up since the start of time. You know, the materials are slightly different. Instead of zinc templates, they would have had wooden templates. Mm. But still just a steel point and just scribe around the shape. This is Alan, and he's very close to finishing, actually. Mm. You can see he's just sort of working through his last cavetto. There's not much in the way of carved decoration or anything like that. It's all about crisp, straight moulding.
How do you keep these straight lines? You're doing it all by hand.
Yeah, well, it's all about practice. It's about learning how to use the chisel sort of efficiently and repetitively. It's a conscious effort to follow your line.
And you can see from the side that there's some different curves going on here, aren't there?
That's right. The shape of the moulding can be achieved quite simply with just a change of chisel. We get all sorts of different tools, you know, that's just a simple ball nose, and that can be used for working your hollows.
And you've really got to think about these things in 3D, haven't you? You've got this template at the end, but it's this idea of it carrying all the way
exactly.
through.
Exactly. One of the struggles with masonry that people can't really get their head around is you draw in two dimensions, but yet you apply all your templates in three dimensions. Mm.
So this looks like a much more complex piece.
This is one of the transom heads, which is one of the horizontal sort of tie pieces, if you like.
Supporting the windows above.
Yep.
It takes
a lot of the load.
So how long will it take you to work something? I mean, this looks so complicated, it must take ages.
The mason wants to be able to achieve something like that in round about 25 days.
Yeah, such highly skilled work. And there's something amazing about this, isn't it? That this is going to go back in to the medieval building. You're using the same techniques. It's going to become part of that story again.
The fact that stones are produced by stonemasons, you know, cathedrals, churches, they're all a celebration of craftsmanship. And, you know, we want to continue that.
The long reign of Edward III came to an end in 1377, but his successor Richard was even more steeped in a Gothic sensibility. A new artistic exuberance would shape national life. Climaxing in the creation of the extraordinary Westminster Hall in the 1390s, the oldest part of the existing Palace of Westminster. Its roof, with angels carrying the royal coat of arms, enclosed the largest single span in Europe at the time. This was a building that would give shape to the monarchy, parliament, and the legal system. Richard also put Gothic art to good use in a manual for royal coronations, known as the Liber Regalis, and referred to today as the Royal Book. The growing genius of Gothic illustrators and painters would contribute to a new sense of the divinity of kings.